If anterior pole skin stretch is less than 2 cm, this means very tight envelope, and better to subtract 30 cc from the estimated starting volume. And if the anterior pole skin stretch is greater than 3 cm, the surgeons add 30 cc. And if anterior pole skin stretch is greater than 4 cm, you have to add 60 cc to the starting volume. If parenchyma fill is greater than 80%, this means already full envelope, and the surgeon subtracts 30 cc from the initial estimated volume. And if parenchyma fill is less than 20%, this means the envelope is already empty, and you have to add 30 cc. There are different options for pocket locations that include total submuscular, partial retropectoral, subfacial, submammary or subglandular, and dual plane. The total submuscular pocket location is more frequently a reconstructive technique. It is less commonly done for augmentation, owing to a more painful and bloody dissection, a tendency for the device to rise superiorly, difficulty in predictably creating a deep and well-formed inframammary fold, particularly laterally. Total submuscular pocket location reduces contour deformities, decreases implant edge visibility, traction rippling, and risks of capsular contraction. However, this procedure has a higher risk of malposition of the implant and breast asymmetry. Subfacial pocket location has not been widely adopted due to an absence of satisfactorily controlled or long-term data. This technique refers to the collocation of the implant behind the fascia and in front of the pectoralis major muscles. Proponents of this technique claim that it offers equivalent protection against capsular contraction. The integrity of the muscle is preserved, and the contracture of the fascia adequately supports the implant without requiring additional tissue and giving adequate aesthetic results. The value of this method is presently unclear. Moreover, the facial layer is generally thin and may prove tedious to dissect. The partial retropectoral pockets are specific entities. The pectoralis major muscle is left intact at the inframammary fold, and the implant is partial retropectoral. The advantages of partial retropectoral location include upper pole aesthetics, better tissue visualization by mammography, and slightly decreased incidence of capsular contracture. However, the disadvantages include greater discomfort and potential breast distortion with pectoralis contraction, and the other is occasionally striking but typically minimal. In submammary or subglandular pocket locations, the implant is placed between the breast tissue and the pectoralis fascia. The main advantage of this position include ease of dissection and less pain, but neither of which is critical enough to favor routine use. However, subglandular pocket location has the following disadvantages. Upper pole contour is compromised and may exhibit ribbons. Capsular contracture is slightly more common than following subpectoral placement, and mammograms are more challenging. It may be a reasonable choice for large pendulous breasts or very low breasts that have little breast muscle overlap. The dual plane allows implant to be beneath the muscle where coverage is needed and against the gland where expansion is necessary, such as a constricted lower pole or a lax lower pole. The dual plane is a continuous spectrum of options, occupying a continuous gray zone between submammary and partial retropectoral. When the pectoralis major muscle is left intact at the inframammary fold, the implant is partial retropectoral. If the muscle is divided along the inframammary fold up to the intersection of the inframammary fold and the lateral sternal border, the technique is termed as dual plane one. If the connections between the muscle and the overlying parenchyma are released so that the muscle slides up to about the inferior border of the areola, it is dual plane two. If released to about the superior border of the areola, it is dual plane three. No matter the extent of the dual plane, the pectoralis major muscle is divided across the inframammary fold only to the point where the inframammary fold joins the lateral sternum, and never superior to this point under any circumstances. The inferior muscle origins are divided before the attachment between the muscle and the gland are transected. Otherwise, control of the muscle position would be lost. The main advantages of dual plane position include: it provides additional tissue padding over the implants, helps to make the implant margins less obvious, avoids muscle coverage elsewhere where it is not needed anyway, so that the muscle cannot pull the implant out of position. In theory, surgeons could have their cake, meaning a submuscular plane, and eat it too, where they still expand the breast skin envelope to treat women with glandular ptosis. Muscle splitting by plane augmentation is a procedure in which a pocket is created simultaneously in the subglandular and submuscular planes, with the implants lying behind and in front of the pectoralis muscle at the same time. Proponents of this technique claim that there is no pectoralis muscle release with this procedure. The pectoralis major muscle has an anterior and posterior relationship to the processes. The breast muscle interface is not specifically altered. However, this procedure permanently sacrifices any coverage benefits from the more inferior portion of the pectoralis. And once the muscle is divided, the amount of coverage that remains is unpredictable. The preference of the incision location for breast augmentation is a personal one that's influenced by many factors, including the patient's understanding of the various options, body habitus and personal requirements, the experience and the preference of the surgeon. You have to keep in mind that each incision exposes different anatomy, has differing level of endogenous bacterial potentially seeding the implant, dissects through different tissues, and allows different amounts of visualization. A recent poll showed that about 62% of surgeons routinely use the inframammary incision, 25% use the periareolar incision, and about 8% use the transaxillary incision. Tibbetts and Adams locate the inframammary fold 7 cm below the nipple for a 200cc implant, and 9.5 centimeters below the nipple for a 400cc implant. While Hidalgo and Spector make the incision 6 centimeters below the nipple, a distance slightly less than the implant radius in a patient treated with a 300cc implant. Abulata et al. Locate the incision 1 cm below the inframammary fold when using implant less than 300 cc and 1.5 cm for implant 3 to 400 cc and 2 cm for implants more than 400 cc. Remember that a supra inframammary fold approach 0.5 to 1 cm reduces the risk of bottoming out or a double bubble deformity in the short term. The scar remains hidden on frontal views and above the inframammary fold in the supine position.